Other things that were happening, well, environmental reporting companies said, well, we should start doing some environmental reporting. A few, not many, very few, in fact, that did it. And we also saw the advent of corporate governance codes that came out. And the first one that came out was the Cadbury Report, which came out in 1993 or 1992 in the UK. It was chaired by Sir Adrian Cadbury. And this was really the first corporate governance code that was issued, encouraging boards of directors and companies to adhere to a code and to be more responsible in what they did. That was followed by what we call King One, the King Report on corporate governance, which came out in 1994. And that advanced Cadbury, and it made some important advances. But if you look at it now, it was somewhat tame, but it was an important step forward in the beginnings of companies beginning to look at the importance of responsibility, importance of openness, transparency. But it was still very early days. We also saw the concept of the triple bottom line coming out in the mid-1990s. And what that really was, that companies began, there was a perception that in the past we'd reported on financial information, we'd produced financial information, but what about social issues? What about environmental issues, economic issues? So the triple bottom line was something that came into being to be able to address some of the challenges that were facing the environment or facing humankind. It really was an early stage of the development, and I'll show you where we've got to now. The problem with it was that it talked about reporting in silos. It didn't integrate those issues. And then we saw towards the end of the 90s, sustainability reporting, and that was really, there were a number of organizations, but the Global Reporting Initiative, GRI, which started in the US and then moved to Holland, came up with guidelines on sustainability reporting, and there have been various iterations. The next one is due in May this year. It'll be launched in Amsterdam next month. And that will be called the G4. So all of these developments were taking place in business. Not all companies adhered to them. They were voluntary. There was no requirement for them to participate. And I just want to look at some of the drivers behind this. Why was this happening? Well, obviously the report of the United Nations report was an important one. But media began to play a very important role. And for example, Dow Chemicals was really under a lot of pressure back in the 1970s. And what happened was television began to highlight these problems that were taking place. Dow was selling napalm gas to the US armed forces. And the general public began to realize what impact that had on the people that were suffered from the napalm gas. And that really started a reaction. The public began to realize, but hang on, some of these chemical companies are doing things that they shouldn't be doing. It was Dow Chemical again in 1984 that was responsible for the Bhopal crisis, where in India there was a leak of poisonous gases, which killed about 8,000 people. And again, it was something that got a lot of coverage, and people began to think about, well, you know, are these companies responsible? Are they actually looking after the environment? And of course, we know what's happened since then, the internet and with Twitter, et cetera, social media, how that has influenced. So those have had a major impact upon how companies have responded and the change in their attitudes. Then in the 2001, we had the Enron crisis, where a number of corporates went out of business almost overnight. Enron was the seventh biggest company in the United States, and it was the shining star. And suddenly, overnight, it went out of business. And it was realized that in fact, that the huge fraud had been perpetrated. And there were a number of companies in 2001 that suffered similar fate. And the problem with that was that investors were saying that, you know, we had invested in this. This was really somewhere where we thought we were safe. It was a blue chip, and it collapsed overnight. Why? And who's responsible? And that was a major problem, but a driver towards improvement of corporate governance. And then lots of government regulations came out in the US. We had Sarbanes-Oxley Act legislation. And since then, we've had lots of legislation in most countries, including our own, to try and prevent these collapses from taking place. We also saw new codes coming out, and King II was actually released immediately after the Enron crisis. King II was again a major step forward as regards corporate governance, and placed South Africa at the head or the lead in corporate governance at that point in time. It included a number of sustainable development aspects to it, and so we can see that this is an evolutionary process that has been taking place, with pressure from governments, from codes, but also consumer pressures also having an impact. And then in 2008, we suffered the financial crisis, which is still affecting us today. This was the banking crisis, the subprime crisis, as some people call it. But it was the collapse of the banks in the US and Europe in particular, which caused major problems for investors. Many people lost lots of money in pension funds and all kinds of investments. And it led to, I think one could call it a recession. It was the biggest recession, depression since 1929. It was a major, major impact upon the world. In South Africa, we saw then the launch of King III, and I believe that you've had some exposure to King III, King III being the code of corporate governance that was issued in September 2009. And this was really a significant step forward from a governance perspective. If we can look at some of the provisions in here, I know that you've been through this, but I'll just highlight a few of them just to illustrate some of the important aspects of it and how sustainability and sustainable development was being introduced into corporate affairs. And this really was, I think, the turning point in corporations. You'll see the heading there, the board should. Board should provide effective leadership based on an ethical foundation. Now that's motherhood and apple pie. That's pretty easy to say. But what are the other things that ensure, the board should ensure that the company is and is seen to be a responsible corporate citizen. Board should ensure that the company's ethics are managed effectively. Should appreciate the strategy, risk, performance, and sustainability are inseparable. So here we bring in sustainability into the business, and the board should be looking at sustainability and recognize it, its importance in terms of the corporate strategy. The board should ensure sustainability reporting and disclosure should be integrated with the company's financial reporting, and went further that companies should produce integrated reports. The board should appreciate that stakeholders' perceptions affect the company's reputation. Again, an emphasis on stakeholders, and I'll talk about stakeholder engagement and how important it is in an organization today.